Thank you for choosing Axxess On Demand. Axxess believes in continuing education, and we create content to empower you to learn and grow anytime, anywhere. Let's get started.
Hello, thank you for joining us for today's webinar, Best Practices for Home-Based Care, Employee Engagement, and Retention. My name is Cully, and I'm on the marketing team at Axxess. Axxess is a leading technology company offering a complete suite of easy-to-use, innovative software solutions, empowering more than 9,000 home health, home care, and hospice organizations to grow their business while making lives better. Joining us today is our moderator and presenter, Eric Scharber, and speakers Ken Albert and Sonnie Linebarger. Eric is a managing principal at SimiTree Healthcare Consulting, leading all talent acquisition and employee retention efforts for clients in the home health and hospice industries. He oversees executive search, interim management, and management recruiting services, as well as advisory services related to talent acquisition and retention. Previously, Eric founded Exact Recruiting and led the firm to become the top recruiting and executive search entity for the industry, serving clients across the United States and placing more than 2,500 professionals since inception. Ken is the president and CEO of Androscoggin Home Healthcare and Hospice. Ken is also the chairman of the board of directors for the National Association for Home Care and Hospice and the chairman of the board of trustees for the Maine College of Health Professions. Prior to this role, Ken served as the director and COO for the Maine Center for Disease Control and Prevention and the director for the Division of Licensing and Regulatory Services within the Maine Department of Health and Human Services. Ken has a background in health law, professional licensing, and regulatory and compliance law. He also worked in emergency and intensive care settings for 17 years, including serving as the Director of Emergency Services at Central Maine Medical Center, as the administrator of the Affiliated Occupational Health Center, as the site manager for Life Flight of Maine, and as a travel critical care nurse. Sonnie is the COO for Bristol Hospice and the host of the Evoke Greatness podcast. Sonnie has a proven record of strategic growth, and she is accountable for more than $300 million in revenue. She is an innovative healthcare leader with expertise in operations, sales, and financial management for hospice and palliative care. She has held former clinical and operational roles for the Phoenix Children's Hospital, Hospice of Arizona, Hospice Compassus, and Silverado. In her 20-plus year journey from CNA to COO, she has become an industry thought leader committed to the transformation, growth, and mentorship of others. Thank you all for joining us today. I want to remind everyone that today's session is being recorded and will be shared with all registrants. Our recent industry trends report done in partnership with SimiTree is also available for download in the GoToWebinar handouts panel section right now. For our agenda, we will begin with a discussion around the importance of engagement and move to key metrics and best practices around compensation, culture, and career development that have helped organizations better retain staff. We will share various data points along the way and include two audience polls that we'd like you to participate in. Please note that everyone is currently muted, but during the webinar, you may submit questions through the questions box function of GoToWebinar. Eric will review and select submitted questions from the chat box to help answer those questions following the initial discussion. Now, I'll pass it to Eric to kick us off.
Thank you, Cully, and welcome, everybody. Thanks for being with us today. I know how busy everybody's schedules are, but I know this topic is of great importance to everyone. So hopefully we're going to make this a really valuable hour of your week here. So again, as Cully mentioned, SimiTree and Axxess got together this December to put together this trends report, right? We did a survey that had over 1,800 respondents talking about all things related to employee engagement, culture, just this challenge that we're seeing with workforce, with the goal of obviously putting out this trends report that could be beneficial to every provider out there. Once that was completed, we thought, you know, the next step would be to produce a webinar, a panel discussion, get a couple of the industry leaders from the standpoint of thought leadership. And I'm real happy to have Ken Albert and Sonnie Linebarger here with us today, both of whom I've known for a really long time. And I consider to be leaders when it comes to the employee and the workforce piece of this business. They're both excellent operators, but they're go-to people when it comes to how to lead people as well. So couldn't have a better panel here today. And I'm real proud to be able to kind of lead this discussion. Our goal is going to be to get you all some takeaways, right? And there's zero chance that we're going to be able to cover this topic at a really deep level in 50 minutes, right? But if Sonnie and Ken and I can produce some conversation that gives everyone on this panel discussion today a takeaway or two, something that they can bring back to the shop, something they can implement right away, or maybe tweak the way they're doing things, then we would consider this a success. At the end of the day, if you think about this workforce challenge that we're dealing with right now, it's massive. And something that I firmly believe in is that there's going to be winners and there's going to be losers when it comes to this whole workforce piece. Meaning, you know, if the data shows, there's no way that there's enough employees out there, right? There's just not enough talent out there the way things stand right now for everyone to have as much talent as they need. So ultimately, organizations that are proactive, that really focus on their employees, that focus on developing strategies that are going to make a difference in employee engagement, on building really strong cultures, retention, they're going to survive, and they're going to thrive, and they're going to become the employers of choice. And that's why we have Ken and Sonnie here today, because they are being proactive with their organizations. The flip side of that is there's also going to be losers. Again, there's not enough to go around, which means those that are reactive, that are continually sort of chasing the tail, if you will, they're going to be the ones that don't make it. They ultimately will get gobbled up via consolidation or go out of business or what have you. Today, we're trying to share some ideas to really have some conversation starters for you and your organization to how can you be ahead of the curve? How can you be the proactive providers out there that are doing things so that you're ultimately a winner when it comes to this whole workforce challenge? I'll say the last thing that's really interesting before we jump into conversation is Sonnie and I were at a conference just a few weeks ago, the Home Care 100 conference, which Ken is normally at. We missed you this year, Ken. But it was interesting that the entire conference seemed to be about workforce. Every session, no matter if it was about regulatory or compliance or whatever the session was about, had elements of workforce built in. I think the industry as a whole has finally realized that this isn't going away. We can't hide from it. And so everyone that's on this webinar today, congratulations, you're doing something about it, right? And that's the point. So we're glad you're here, and we hope we can provide you with some valuable content over this next 50 minutes or so. So with that, we're going to start this webinar off with a poll question. So it's going to pop up on your screen, and we'd really love you guys to take 2 seconds and just put what you think. What area in your organization have been most negatively impacted by turnover? And while everyone's selecting what their vote is, let me kick it off by just having both Ken and Sonnie. Ken, I'll start with you. What's your thoughts on this poll question from your point of view at Androscoggin?
I think it's, you know, Eric, first off, thank you very much for having me today. Nice to be here with Sonnie and you and the Axxess team. I think the focus is really on ability to grow for me. That ties right into the financial success. I think that the entire healthcare workforce in the industry, whether it's acute care, primary care, post-acute, we're all experiencing this workforce shortage. And you know, for here in Maine, for example, we have the oldest mean age of any other nation in the state. We have across the country a tsunami coming at us of aging, of an aging population. So the demand is massive, and we need to be able to grow our services in order to meet that demand. And absent that workforce, we're just not able to do so.
Yeah, that's perfect. Sonnie?
Yeah, I think looking at all of these, you could probably weave all of these into having some sort of impact, some bigger than others. When you don't have the amount of staff that you need that impedes on your ability to grow, I think we've seen multiple studies and articles that have come out recently on companies who had to turn down referrals or admissions. So when you think about the ability to grow there, that's really impacted, as well as the financial success. Looking at not having enough staffing, looking at the wage inflation and how we're all navigating that, I think, you know, all of these are really have the opportunity to be impacted.
That's so true. And I think we're going to put the results up. But I think, yeah, looking there, I was going to say each of those answers, I believe, affect each other as well. So if you think about it, employee engagement probably affects quality outcomes. Financial success affects your ability to grow. Vice versa. So it goes back and forth. But, you know, we kind of identified these as the areas that organizations are being negatively impacted by turnover the most. So, you know, moving from that poll and thinking about our first topic, and just so everyone here understands, what we're going to do today is cover, this is going to be very conversational. We kind of identified several topics that we wanted to hit on. I'm going to have both Ken and Sonnie kind of give their opinions on each topic. We'll have some follow-up conversations. Ken and Sonnie, feel free to ping each other as well. So very conversational. We're going to start with this topic of what I'm calling the why piece of it, right? We have to focus on turnover, have to focus on retention strategies, building good cultures, employee engagement. It's hard work. It's not easy. It's a lot of elbow grease. It takes a lot of you all's time in the executive roles that you're in. So as you contemplate all this hard work that you're doing, and I'll start with you, Sonnie, you know, why is it worth it? You know, why do you do it on a daily basis?
Yeah, I think you have to lead off with the foot of that employee engagement or that employee experience. We talked a lot about this at the Home Care 100 conference around what does that experience look like? And do our organizations, each of our organizations, understand what that experience looks like? And so it has the ability, if you are not focusing on this, you have the ability to impact your culture and your morale overall. And that is going to directly impact that patient experience. But then it's layered, similar to the poll. When you think about financially, just in the most recent studies, which are different than they have been in previous years because of all the shift in workforce, the cost of losing an employee right now is anywhere from 6 to 9 months worth of their annual salary. That's just the cost of losing the employee. Then you factor in time and resources to be able to recruit and train and bring on that new person. You're looking at 100% plus of that annual salary financially just to replace them. Then you think about operationally, you have a decreased amount of productivity, or you're kind of taking that workload and you're putting it on somebody else for the time being. And so you factor that in. It could be really detrimental to the organization overall. And as I mentioned earlier, then you have got that additional layer of the culture and the morale that's impacted. And so I think for all of these reasons, us all tapping into our why, similar to why we're in the job that we're in, which is home care, healthcare, and then hospice, you know, really taking care of people at end of life. What is that why? We should understand what is fundamentally important to our teams and to our all of the people in our organization so that we can really speak to that.
Yeah, agree with all that. Ken, same question, but I'll kind of piggyback off of Sonnie there. Do you all have a specific number that you tie to losing a key employee, the replacement cost of key employees as well? Curious if you could share that. And then, you know, your thoughts on why you spend so much time doing what we're doing.
Yeah, so I started at Androscoggin about 5 years ago, and that was one of the first things I looked at was what's our cost of replacement. It's been a number you like to have in your back pocket no matter what position I'm in, right? So at the time, it was anywhere between $80,000 and $100,000. Now we're at about $130,000 to $150,000, depending upon that position. So that is for every FTE, full-time FTE you turn over, that's roughly the cost of replacement. So, and there's a lot of factors that go into that, but you need to know what that number is, because if you're looking at recruitment strategies and investment in recruitment strategies and retention strategies, you can use that as an offset to your financial analysis there. I think that, you know, I hope that for most of us, and I think it's true, that the workforce shortage is not what's driving our desire to be an employer of choice, right? We hire for the work that we do. We hire for our mission in healthcare. But for many folks, you know, that I talk to, this really is putting a primary focus on culture and kind of what the rationale is for being an employer of choice. I think it's making us look more closely at the kind of at our culture and what's and being employer of choice is part of the fabric of that culture within which we work. And I think we have to step back and the goal is to become an employer of choice. Being super honest with yourself and having your leadership team be really honest and ask the question, are we an employer of choice? And what is the gap analysis there? What do we honestly believe is the gap between yes and no to answering that question? And then using the answers to that as part of the fodder for developing your strategy moving forward.
So follow up on that then, just for each of you, since you're in, you know, C-suite roles with large organizations, you got plenty of stuff to do from your operations standpoint. I'm sure all the providers out there would also like to know this, is how much time let's say in a given week, do you both allocate to this part of the business, the people part of the business? I mean, you're not in HR per se, although I agree, I believe it starts at the top at your all's level. So as a percentage, a rough guess, Ken, how much time do you think you spend on this a week?
Wow, that's, I would say probably 10 to 15 hours a week on various aspects of employer of choice strategies and employee experience.
And has that gone up recently? Is it been more and more?
Right.
Okay. Yeah. Sonny, same question?
Yeah, and I'd say probably 30 to 40% of my time is spent here. And it made me think of something going back to David Beata mentioned this mm-hmm. in the Home Care 100 conference around the fact that he was trying to get a really good bird's eye view as to what the employee experience looks like. And I think that's it's worthwhile for everyone, especially from the top down, to understand what that experience looks like. And what he said I thought was fascinating. And that was, how many of you have gone and gotten a job at Uber and driven for them for a few days? How many of you have gone and picked up and delivered a few meals for DoorDash and experienced what another company's onboarding experience looks like? Then you can base it up against what yours looks like. And so yeah. there have been some really valuable insights that I've gained out of that to start looking inward from, you know, from our company. But I think we could all glean something from that.
That's a great point. And in the trends report that again, you all have access to, you'll see that the onboarding was a huge hit. Like that's what a lot of folks are talking about, why they were leaving roles or why retention wasn't work out. We're going to talk about a couple other points. That's a great point, Sonny. And in fact, total kind of rabbit hole, but you know, I think along that same vein, try to apply at some of these other organizations and see how easy it is to get a job at some of these other organizations, an Uber, whatever the case may be. It's simple. They make it simple to make it fast, you know, just super easy to actually get your application, to get that process going. And then go to your own company's website and see how easy and is it mobily optimized and can you do it in just a few minutes? That's a total side note, but very important to the whole experience of joining somebody's organization. So it's a great point. So that's the why. We wanted to kind of say, look, there is an ROI here. We want to do it. We want to focus on that. And part of today, again, is to try and give everybody some takeaways. And so we want to talk a little bit about the how, right? The how that we actually do it. So Gallup put out a statistic a couple years ago that said 54% of all turnover was avoidable, right? So wrap your brains around that. Depending on how large your organization is, maybe you lost 20 employees, maybe you lost 5, maybe you lost 100, depending on how large your organization is. What if you only lost half? And how much better off would your organization be if you only lost half the employees that you actually lost? Now, it doesn't come easy. It's with a lot of elbow grease, a lot of the strategies and tactics around employee retention. So that's what I'm going to ask is the how is, you know, each of you, can you share something with the group here? What's working from a retention strategy standpoint? Maybe, and Kim, we'll start with you, a couple ideas, a couple things that have worked for you and Androscoggin.
Yeah, so, well, I'm happy to be here. I do not pretend to be the expert here. I think we're all learning as we move through this process, right? So, and learning from each other, thankfully, which is great about this industry, right? As we share things, even though we're competitors, we really share and work together. And I think a couple things. First off, part of our key metrics for executive compensation this year for our entire team was application to hire. So we built that into our executive comp package. So looking at that, just that application strategy, the employee experience from the moment they access a website or click a link to go and apply for the position, ensuring that they have a good experience. What's our time frames from the time that they hit enter on that application process to the time they have a touch point with the organization, a contact? And then also, you know, as the onboarding process goes on, we have HR touch points, management touch points, and executive touch points with those employees at 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, 6 months, and then 1 year. And then, you know, the strategies moving forward, I think it's really important to sit down with those employees and authentically ask them what their experience is like, and then report back that to your full leadership team, if not your entire employee base, about what the employee experience has been, because all of our employees have an opportunity to contribute to the success of that new employee coming on board, right? And so it's really a team effort. I think what works, and part of what doesn't work, I think that recruitment bonuses, absent stay bonuses don't work. I think it's offensive to
folks. Recruitment bonuses, Ken, are you talking about specifically what's a recruitment? What are you defining as a recruitment bonus?
Yeah, so when you're offering sign-on bonuses to people.
Right?
Yep. So then we have employee recruitment bonuses where we compensate employees who bring somebody in who's a qualified hire. But you also have to look at what are you doing with your employees? You can't be just offering recruitment bonuses. You know, what are you doing from a bonus standpoint for stay bonuses? And to your point earlier, as well as Sonny's point, it is culture. It's not just a word. You have to look at all aspects of that culture and the relationships that your employees, whether they're tenured employees or new employees, what are those relationships that they're engaging in throughout your organization, whether it's at the help desk in IS, whether it's in human resources, whether it's in payroll or their supervisors or the C-suite, what is their relationship, and being honest with yourself about opportunities to enhance those relationships. I also think acknowledging that a work-life balance is a very, money is certainly, I think this survey you referenced earlier, for the first time in a long time, money is really a driving factor here, right? But I also think work-life balance is really important to folks in being able to enjoy their free time. And so having systems in place, having tools in place, having EHRs, EMRs in place that really support the success of that employee, regardless of whether they're, front office or back office in the field. I think you have to look at that very seriously, work with your vendors to maximize the ability for your employees to have work-life balance. It's part of that quadruple aim that we talk about. We focus on the triple aim for a lot of years in healthcare. And the quadruple aim is, if we don't allow our employees to focus on their own health and wellness and their own development, we're never going to be able to achieve the triple aim, I believe, in my own humble opinion. So, and I think it starts with really good hiring. Eric, cut me off whenever you want to hear, okay?
finish up, yeah.
I think it starts with really good hiring. Understanding what your organization has to offer, understanding your organizational values, and seeking through the hiring process and the interview process to ensure that there's alignment between the individual's professional values, personal values, if you will, and what the organizational values are overall. To the extent that you can achieve alignment there, the better off you're going to, the longer you're going to have that employee engaging in a happy way in your organization. We also started offering ride-alongs, so prior to offering as a contingency for offering a job. So, if you're hiring somebody from an acute care setting or a primary care setting, going into the home can be a really unique experience. So, it used to be, for many years we did this it was voluntary, but now it's a requirement for all of our applicants to offer a ride-along scenario. Give them a chance to ride with a clinician for a day. Even that relationship they develop with that clinician is super important, but the ability to go into folks' homes and understand what they're going to be faced with, I think is valuable.
That's awesome. No, it's great points. I think there's some definite takeaways for everyone there. I mean, Sonny, same thing. And in your organization also, I think what's nice about this panel is Ken, you're sort of geographically concentrated in one, good sized market there in Maine. And Sonny, you've got employees all over the country, in essence, in various parts. So what works for you guys when you're thinking about how you retain staff? And even to Ken's point a moment ago, what doesn't work? So what's been your experience?
Yeah, I think, so when you get to the recruiting bonuses and sign-on bonuses and retention bonuses, those all right now, those are what we have to do to survive. And mm-hmm. I think we understand that. I will say, you know, though this may not be a popular opinion, I think throwing money at the problem is not a long-term sustainable solution, right? So we have to get a little bit deeper into what is causing this shift. And so it's a number of the points that we've talked about already. And I had a podcast episode a couple of weeks ago where this was the topic of conversation, and it brought forth something. This was a technology company that I was speaking to. This wasn't even healthcare. And so healthcare becomes way more intimate. And the closeness of our employees, the connections and the community are something that stopped 2 years ago. And I think we have to make sure that we really understand what that means. Though leaders may not be sitting around those same IDT tables every week, our teams were, and they felt a sense of community and a sense of connectedness to one another. And we'd be foolish to not take that back into consideration. And so as we look at that, how do we balance all of that, maintaining a community and connection in this kind of new virtual world? How do we look where we were used to having everybody in person, whether it was our meetings to discuss patient updates or going out and seeing patients? Everything was done in person. And I think we're at a point where we have to start thinking about that differently. So maybe that's a combination. I think it's difficult to try to maintain the connectedness 100% virtually. And for those who have mastered that, please share with the rest of us. But I think, you know, it's a different feel when you sit down in front of another human and you connect with them. And, you know, you're talking about what happened last week and you feel a sense that, again, that sense of community. And so we have to start thinking differently. That may look like hybrid roles. That may look at, you know, as we think about what we're offering as different positions, we're thinking outside of the box. Gone are the days where, you know, hospice or home care was black and white, right? Mm-hmm. If we want to maintain keeping the staff that we have and recruiting new staff, we have to start thinking differently. And that goes back to that first point of understanding what's fundamentally important to our team members and our prospective employees. And that is, what does that balance look like to them? Ken talked about that work-life balance, and maybe that's working from home a couple of days a week, doing something from a tele perspective, or while we were used to all of our billing staff and other staff sat in the office every single day, was that necessary? We're finding no, it really wasn't, right? They can still, right. can still do the same job from home. And so we as employers should be thinking differently about how do we color this future for our teams and our prospective team members to be appealing, to be something that they want to be a part of. Because I think there are a lot of bottlenecks in most companies. And if you take a minute and you start asking the people who are in the mix of it, they have a lot of solutions. Our team members have so many solutions that can fix some complex problems if we're willing to stop and take a listen and really acknowledge and find out, what are they seeing? What is that employee experience from their lens, not ours? And so I think it's worthwhile for organizations to begin looking at this very differently.
That's a great point. And the one that kind of struck me is, you know, looking at it through their lens, there was a saying that someone mentioned, and I don't know if it was our group on the planning calls, but, or something I read, but it was, are we selling what they're buying? In other words, you know, are we putting forth a culture and a environment and an organization that this generation of employees, especially that millennial generation, is looking for in an employer? So are we selling what they're buying? Ask yourself that, everyone. There was one other piece that I thought was really interesting that a couple of organizations have done in this industry when it comes to the how part of it, and they've implemented this mentor buddy system. And it's at all levels, whether it's a caregiver, whether it's a nurse, whether it's a manager, where they're assigned someone who's been with the organization maybe a year or longer, that's not their boss, that they don't report to, that they may not even be in the same department as, to have a sounding board and have a weekly conversation after the first few months, and then a monthly, and then ultimately a quarterly, and so on. By the way, that costs you zero. Just a little bit of time, right, from somebody, but it's an idea that the organizations who have implemented it and talked to me about it, they've moved the needle on retention. So one last question on this topic before we move on to the next one, a quick question, So quick answer, Ken, who owns these strategies? When you start thinking about retention strategies and coming up with what might work in your organization, who owns it at Androscoggin? Where does it start?
So it's not, it used to rest within the chief human resource officer, right?
Yep.
That is no longer the case. I think from a practical standpoint and execution standpoint, it resides there, but it is owned by every leader throughout this organization.
That's awesome answer. Sonny, I'm imagining something similar.
To remember that it starts with that first touch. That may be a number. If you're reaching out to somebody on LinkedIn, maybe that's me making that first touch. Maybe it's an ad that they see. So from the minute that touch happens, you have to be able to have every single person equally execute on it.
Perfect. So we'll keep rolling. Sonny, you brought up a topic in our kind of prep calls about, we spend so much time talking about the clinicians and the frontline employees and the caregivers and the nurses and therapists, as we should, 100%, that's the frontline. But there's also been a bit of a trend in the past 18 months to 2 years of higher than average turnover with administrative staff, with management staff, with executive staff. I've seen it in our practice of recruiting and search work, those level positions, there's more movement there than there's been in my entire career. And so I'm curious what trends you're seeing within Bristol as far as those types of staff. You can kind of touch on administrative as well as those kind of management leadership roles. And then also just maybe touch on, do you approach retention strategies differently for different levels of people? So the non-clinicians in the field.
Yeah. So this level right now is being heavily recruited. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you don't think that your leaders right now are getting calls and emails and offers just as much as our clinicians are, right? Everybody is trying to vie for who you have. And so you have to be really, really mindful and thoughtful as to what that looks like to retain those folks. And I think in the industry, we're at a time where their leaders are contemplating their future. What do they want to be a part of? What is their vision and mission versus what they're seeing, again, out of their lens, not your lens? What do they want to be a part of? And some larger healthcare organizations, home care, hospice, they're having some disruptions. And I think we all, you know, we read the articles every day, we go to the conferences, we understand that there is some unease or dis-ease in some organizations. And guess what? That makes you a prime target to have your leadership taken. And so, you know, thinking about the loss of a leader and the impact that that can have on an organization, that can turn a small crack in your organization to a fracture in your foundation. And you should treat it as such. If you aren't having regular connection, again, that community and connectedness, if you aren't having regular one-to-ones with your leaders, I would strongly urge you to start. What are they seeing? What are they hearing? What are their retention strategies for their teams, right? Because it's this ripple effect all the way from the top down. And if they feel like they belong to a really good place, they're going to have that same feel with the people who report to them. And so as you think about it, do you know what your leader's goals are?
Yeah.
Have you asked them what's important to them? Do you know what they want to do in the next couple of years? Are you, as an organization and as a leader, laying pavers in front of them to make sure that that happens, or creating, you know, alternate opportunities for them? And so that's what you should think about. You should think about, there are many unintended consequences of losing key leaders in an organization. Mm-hmm. I think we probably all at one time or another felt what that looks like, you know, felt what that feels like. And there can be some serious unintended consequences there. And so I think you do have to approach it differently, because while we don't want to lose anyone, when you have the kind of that weak point of losing a leader in an organization, that allows for multiple others to be impacted by that.
Great points. Ken, same question. You know, what have you seen at the leadership level and even maybe the administrative level within Androscoggin?
Yes, I actually was, you know, as we were discussing this in prep, I went back to look, and over the past 2 years, we're less than 3% turnover in our leadership ranks. So I like knock off, when would I say that, right? So, and I'm not sure if we're just doing something right or what there, but I Sonnie, I want to go back to something you, what, you know, you were saying. I think it's so important today. You mentioned in your answers to all of these questions so far, you talked about connectedness and community. And so we, over the past 4 months, we've had a guest speaker. We do a management day every year, every month. And then part of that, Eric actually just spoke at our last management day on a particular topic. But we had the same speaker for 4 months. We were really diving deeply into our culture and trying to ascertain, like, what is it about us? Okay, is it a good culture? What is it? And this sense of belonging and being able to articulate an option to belong, a choice to belong to something that is either greater than you or a mission that is greater than you, that sense of connectedness is at the end of the day, what we ended up describing for ourselves is something that is vitally, vitally important to the workforce today. But I think if you go back, you know, we were did some work with Brené Brown, and if you ever done any reading on her work, and the distinction between fitting into an organization and belonging to an organization is very, very different there, right? And so understanding what it means for your workforce to belong, for your leadership to belong to something, I think is really important. I think mentoring programs, Eric, in leadership, I think are really important. Again, used to be voluntary. Now we've got, you know, it still is voluntary, but we're strongly encouraged, but depending upon your kind of your seniority and sophistication as a leader. But using the skill set of your more senior leaders as mentors for your of your other leaders. And it can't be, it's got to be a defined mentoring program. I don't think it can be, you know, it has to be facilitated by a sponsor within your organization. Then we also started this year, I think, with the whole concept of building resilience in your workforce. We started a program called Andro Connect, which is, again, once a month, informal, led by our HR leadership, kind of focus, allowing an informal atmosphere for leadership to talk about specific subjects, you know, no holds barred, non-judgmental environment, just to help with their resilience factor.
Yeah, those are good points. I love that, as far as really focusing on the development of the leaders. And hopefully, Sonnie, your video went away. Hopefully we didn't lose you, but I'm sure you'll jump back on. One of the things that I've noticed just being in this space from the recruiting standpoint, when you think about your leadership level type employees and what you all need to do, and Ken, congrats on not losing your leaders. I think that's a testament to this focus on culture you've put together. But folks, think about the level of interest from the investor community in our space, right? Private equity, Wall Street, you name it, right? There's so many investors out there that want to be and home and community-based services. And so as you think about your leadership talent, as you're developing and building up really top-level people, the number twos and number threes within your organization, I think you do have to really focus, to Ken's point, on making sure they feel like they belong, because the appetite to pluck these folks who have been successful as that number two, if you will, at successful organizations is as high as it's ever been. And the number of folks that are wanting to get into this industry, it's more than it ever has been. There's so much interest in our industry, which is a good thing, because it means we have a healthy industry, right? But it does mean you sort of have to protect your house. So don't just think about your clinicians and your caregivers. I believe they're the most important, but we wanted to bring up this whole topic of that next level of leadership as well when you think about retention. Sonnie, are you with us and just no camera, or? Okay, well, we'll hope she is able to jump on, but Ken, you and I'll drive it for now. You talked on compensation, and if we could put up that second poll first, we want to talk a little bit about compensation as come point. So do you believe your organization provides competitive base pay based on your local market? What we're trying to get at here is just the perception of everybody on this call. We want to get what people are feeling like is going on within organizations within their local markets. You know, just some commentary on this. If I look back over the last 10 years of the trends related to statistics and compensation, We at my organization have done a lot of surveying through the years, a lot of these trend reports, and often what we're trying to get at is what were the reasons people left organizations or what they're looking for in an organization going forward. And historically and very consistently, compensation has not ranked as the main reason why someone leaves an organization. In fact, normally it's somewhere around 3 or 4 as far as the rank and why someone left. You know, ultimately you'll see work-life balance, you'll see company culture, you'll see relationships with supervisors, these types of things, but compensation typically is a couple ticks down. That really wasn't the case in this trends report. And I know this is just one survey, but we saw that compensation was in fact, like it was what was ranked the highest as far as why people are leaving organizations, you know, and that's it's going to get a bit of a difference. And so I actually made some phone calls and reached out to several folks there, Sonny, within the organization. So there we go. So do you believe your organization provides, so this is good. So 51% yes. So you got 40% saying no. So wrap your brains around that, folks. And another 10% that don't know. So really, maybe it's 50-50. And thank you for that poll question. So the point is, I reached out to several folks within the industry who do some of this survey and have some of this data as well. And they're seeing the same thing. They're seeing that compensation has become a much bigger obstacle or much bigger reason, if you will, on you know why folks are leaving. And so we've all seen it. I think we all just went through budget season in the fourth quarter, right? And started thinking about raises and advancements and whatnot. And it was a pretty interesting exercise even for us at SimiTree. And so I guess my questions or what I'd love to get some opinions from you guys both is, Ken, in your market, and we'll start with you, what have you seen as far as increases in compensation? I think there's increases every year, but did you see an additional increase, an increased percentage, if you will, this year? And, you know, how do you manage that given the fact that, hey, just because we have to pay more doesn't mean we can bill more, right? So talk a little bit about that, Ken.
Yeah, so absolutely. The past, our senior leadership team was just talking about it today, even though we used to do market surveys once a year. We're now doing them 2 times a year, and then we're doing kind of pulse checks, you know, formal twice a year with pulse checks, perhaps once a quarter even. And we're feeling the need to do it again right now, even though we just completed it. We're just this sense out there from those that we're trying to recruit that even though we felt even a month ago like we were right squarely within the market, like we're again just being edged out of the market a little bit. I think we've seen a significant increase over the past, you know, 18 months to a year, and it's just shifting on a regular basis. So, you know,
when you say significant increase, I'm just curious if you could put some numbers to that as a person. What have you seen this past year as far as the increase on average?
So I'm looking at like a 10% increase in salaries across the board. From like, you know, I would say like 18 months ago. And my sense is, and I'm looking at nursing. CNAs, I would say, is even higher. I would say CNAs are probably upwards of 20% increase in their salaries over the last 18 months. And that's CNAs in our market now are being paid what LPNs were a year ago.
Wow.
And there's no sign of that going away.
Interesting. So Sonny, same thing. What have you seen within your organization? I'll ask you the same question, you know, as a percentage, you know, what have you seen?
I would say a solid, probably 18 to 20% overall, collectively, when you look at that. Same thing. So we have our aides who are in some markets making what our LPNs and LVNs were previously. So very, very similar. And then really kind of is dependent on the state that you're in. We cover 15 states. And so that becomes really, really challenging for some of those states where there is more of an uptick than anywhere else. And so then you have to think about what is your footprint or your volume of staff that are within that area. We're trying to do pulse points. We just did budget season, you know, end of Q4. And we took a look at every discipline in every single market as we went through budgets. And then I think we've probably done it 4 times since then.
Yeah.
It's kind of a constant that you're evaluating that. But something I found that was really interesting, staffing agencies, right, they're paying up the nose. Yep. We have lost some staff to travel agencies, to staffing agencies. You have hospitals who are trying to get your vaccinated nurses. You know, so there's all these strategies that everyone has that you're either the driver or the receiver of that, you know, one or the other. But what I found was really interesting is people who feel that sense of purpose in their work. So I think about a specific situation, hospice nurse, absolute hospice heart, loves, lives and breathes hospice. Knows that that's her gift and where she receives the most fulfillment. And she said, I have to take this travel agency job. Mm-hmm. I have to. It means that I'm going to ride this wave for as long as I can. I don't want to leave hospice, but I'm going to ride this wave as long as I can and try to financially get as much as I can out of this so I can pay off my student loans, so I can pay off my car, so I can try to pay off some of my debt. And I think that's the piece that you have to think about. And so that's where that, again, that creative piece comes into it. And is somebody taking a different job or someone not taking your job because childcare issues? So when you think about the creativity around what perks or added benefits that you're willing to offer, you know, be thinking about childcare stipends, be thinking about loan repayment or tuition, you know, higher amount of tuition reimbursement. We all used to function inside this box where just about everybody did just about the same, you know, benefit. Yeah. And we're not there anymore. Now we have to get really creative, and we're not going to do so until we figure out what that delta is that someone is looking for. But, you know, when you think about people who their heart is really in what they do, and that's a lot of our team members who care for patients on a daily basis, they love what they do. And they're going to get paid really, really well to go do this kind of temporary stint.
And that pops a question in my mind, Sonnie. Are you treating this when you're kind of thinking long term for your organization? Do you think this is a permanent thing? Do you think it's temporary as far as these big opportunities? And I know some of it was COVID related and whatnot, but there's still such a huge shortage everywhere. I'm seeing nurses take jobs just on a travel assignment in a normal ICU, you know, and they're getting paid ridiculous money to do it. Good for them. But are you planning long term to combat that? Or do you think this is temporary thing?
I think it's temporary.
Okay. What is temporary?
I don't think we'll see all of this as the new normal from here forward.
Okay.
I think there will be some of it. It will shift some things in our industry. But I don't see it as I see it as a kind of a wave, right? And you have to ride and navigate that to the best of your ability. And then you have to think about what do you have to change? What do you have to do differently as a result? With this 18 to 20% increase in wages overall, you know, you got to go back to have the conversation. You know, I'm sure a lot of us are involved in NHPCO and NOC and all of these organizations and kind of the lobbying around what is that reimbursement change? That doesn't change. We're not getting paid any more money, and yet we have 18 to 20% higher wages. And so it's our responsibility to keep that on the docket, to continue pushing, continue having those conversations.
That's great. Well said. You know, so first off, I'm about halfway through my notes of what we wanted to cover. And I just looked at my clock and I'm like, wow, we've got like 10, 12 minutes left. So I'm going to keep going just for that, even though I'd love to drill down even more on the compensation piece. So the next little topic we had was culture. And we've already talked a lot on culture and how important it is. So I think we all can agree it's important. We know that piece. It's definitely a pillar to retaining staff and the engagement, all that. So my kind of question was, my hypothetical question for you both, and Kim, we'll start with you. We'll start with you, Sonnie. If you were a new executive and you were with an organization who really hadn't made culture part of the main focus that it should be, right? And so you're stepping into an organization, and I'm coming at this from the standpoint of maybe there's providers on this phone who are on this call who maybe they have great cultures, maybe they have okay cultures, but they want to improve upon it. You both are so focused on culture and have done some really good things. You could get lost in the sea of what to do. How do you start? You know, where do you go to get started to move forward with bettering a culture? Sonnie, go ahead.
Yeah, I think if I was completely new to this role and trying to figure out what the water, you know, you have to get the temperature of the waters, right? And you're not going to do that from the ivory tower. You may think you are, but you're not. You're going to go and you're going to get really good feedback of How are the in my world, the executive directors who are running individual locations all over the country, what are they hearing and feeling and seeing? You know, take the time. It's well worth it. It's an investment of your time to go out and find out from people what they think is going well and what they don't think is going well. What suggestions do they have?
Yeah.
I think that's part of the piece of inclusivity. Mm-hmm. Is that inclusivity does not just, it's not at the top. That inclusivity really is all of the layers all the way down. And to be a leader who is willing to hear and listen and really acknowledge what the actual experience is versus what your understanding of the experience is to be, I think that's where you start.
That's great. Ken, same question. New, diving in, where do you start? What's the first things first?
Yeah, so I think it's, you know, you have an honest conversation with leadership. I would also rely on data. So there are independent third parties that will actually come in and survey your employees. We use a company called Best Places to Work. It's a, you know, Best Place to Work America company, but they do they provide you with feedback from your employees. It's a confidential survey for your employees, and there are other companies that provide that. But really look at that data. And once you get the data, report that data back to your employees because they gave it to you in the first place, right? They took the time to fill out the survey. Tell them what the data said and tell them what the action plan is to fill that the gaps in where you're not aligning with best practice standards or I think you also have to, as a leader, as an executive, what is the vision? That's your job, is to set the vision for the organization, right? And be able to articulate that in a simple, easy way. And then what's the action plan to get there? What are your strategies? And then you got to hold people accountable. If you have people on your leadership team that are not getting on board with the desired culture in your organization, and you know, sometimes you just got to move people on. And holding each other accountable in a professional and respectful way, when we say things or do things or enact workflows or policies that aren't consistent with that employer of choice culture, giving all of ourselves permission to raise our hands and say, that may not be the best approach in this situation, no matter who we are, the CEO or you know, it doesn't matter, CFO, right? So. And allowing that culture to cultivate a culture where anybody can identify something that would improve the overall environment for our workforce.
And Ken, you mentioned something a few topics ago where you were talking about quality of life and what you could do to help your quality of life, because I think that plays a big part in the company culture, obviously. And you started touching on or maybe it was Sonnie, both of you kind of touched on the whole quality of life, but the technology piece. I'm curious, you know, you're using data, you're using technology to get information to kind of manage better. And one of you was talking about EMRs or just other technology systems. What role do you think technology plays now? I mean, how do you look at it in building a good culture? And are you looking at any new technologies as well? I mean, there's predictive analytics platforms out there that can help you have warnings for people who might be leaving, right? There's all types of technology on the horizon, I think, that could help you manage your culture, hopefully manage retention and turnover. But Ken, what role does technology have in all this?
Yeah, so I'm just gonna, this device right here, right? So
yeah,
we order groceries, we do our banking, we communicate with family, we network socially. I think that the handheld device is, you know, anything that you can do with your benefits management, with your employee engagement strategies that are app-based and using the technology is the way to go. Paper forms and all that, I mean, you've got to get rid of that, right? You've got to invest. Because, and especially, you know, I talk to our millennial employees. If you're not using app-based initiatives within your organization, mm-hmm. you are viewed as outdated mm-hmm. and you know, certainly not aligned with an organization or a company that they want to invest their time and talent into in the long term. You've got to be meeting them where they're at with regard to technology.
Sonnie, anything else, comments on the technology part of this whole?
Yeah, I think same thing. So many of our team members are electronically engaged. They're technologically savvy. And so you have to use that, whether that's forms of communication or way of engaging, getting increased amounts of engagement. And then there are softwares. I mean, every software you could think of. We used to rely on the Bureau of Labor Statistics, for the love of Pete. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's like years old data that we would look at to evaluate whether or not we were paying fairly. And so I think there's a lot of software. All you have to do is Google, you know, any sort of software that you want, whether that's compensation analysis, whether that's recruiting, retention. There are solutions out there to solve your problem. I think it's a matter of making the investment, and both from an organization perspective, but from a leadership perspective.
Yeah. And I think you touched on, both of you, on the biggest point is that this generational aspect of what we're doing with the millennial generation, which, by the way, as of 2020, they said was 50% of the workforce. And by 2025, they say 75% of the workforce is millennials. And obviously technology is big to that generation. So I had on my list multiple other topics, including professional growth and development, leadership qualities, things like that, which we're not going to have time to get to. I want to wrap up and then just leave a minute or two for questions. So if you have a question, drop it in the chat, folks. But Sonnie, just final thoughts. If you could give any kind of passing words of advice to folks as they're dealing with this workforce challenge and thinking about employee engagement, you know, what do you want to leave us with?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I will continue to hone in just on that connectedness. If you are connected with your people, they have less of a reason or chance to be looking elsewhere. Protect that relationship and make sure that they feel seen and heard and included in what you do. You have to be an inspirational leader. People don't, I think the saying is, people don't have to believe what you say. They have to believe you believe what you say. And so if you are painting this picture and this of a vision and a mission that is beautiful and something they want to be a part of. Yes, there's going to be work, but it's something that they want to be a part of. People are going to want to come to an organization like that. And then you have to hold on to those people and protect them.
I agree with that, Sonnie. And to your point, Sonnie, I mean, you do such a great job of that inspirational leadership point, but not every company has a Sonnie. And if you're a wise leader and you know that's not you, you're not the inspirational rah-rah person, find someone in your organization who is and empower them, you know, at that leadership level, but empower them to do that part of the job for you, because, you know, employees need that, right? They want that. So thank you, Sonnie. Ken, I mean, final thoughts on anything related to this? And then also, Ken, we talked a little bit in our prep. You're an active member on NAC, obviously, hold the role there. Tell us a little bit about that real quick. There's NAC's doing an image campaign for the whole industry. When you mentioned that, I thought it was super interesting, and I'd love to just real high level quickly understand what that is as well.
Yeah, sure. So I think, you know, the National Association, in collaboration with the, you know, Home Care Association of America, the Medicaid partnership, you know, we're really collaborating around several workforce initiatives. But the National Association in particular is looking at, you know, what is the image of home care? You know, for a long time, I think I'm going to use, you know, it may be a little bit derogatory, but, you know, it's a place to go to retire as a healthcare professional. That just is not the case anymore, right? I mean, you have high skill, high tech needs, and in the field today. It's not like it used to be, for sure. And so, you know, on a very large scale nationally, working with a national media firm, what is the image of home care? How can we attract not only healthcare workers that are existing into the home care and hospice field, but also how can we attract young individuals who are making a decision about their career path and their educational path into healthcare and then into home care and hospice as a career? So we need to blanket the United States with this effort at this point. I'd also add to that, you know, advocacy, right? There are several bills that are out there at the federal level that we're watching and actively engaged in. But if you have an opportunity to advocate in your individual states around reimbursement rates, particularly Medicaid, Navigating rate negotiations with third-party payers, you've got to be able to have the data to sit down with the administrations and the legislature to be able to talk about the salary increases and in comparison to what the reimbursement increases or lack thereof have been. But you also have to be able to share that data with third-party payers as you're negotiating rates. It is unlike any environment that I've seen in my too long career in healthcare right now. So data is very powerful, and ensuring that there's a path forward to advocacy with your congressional delegation as well as in your state legislatures, I think is really important right now.
Thank you, Ken. Yeah, that's great. So we're almost wrapped up. We have a question, a couple in here, but we'll hit this one. What have you found to be the best metric tool to evaluate employee satisfaction? I think that's the most important here. Are you guys using, Ken, you mentioned a survey organization that you were working with. Sonnie, are you working with any specific organizations that are helping you manage?
Yeah, so we do internal surveys as well. But I think some of the most important feedback that you can get is right after someone begins with your company. So it's like a new hire survey to figure out, hey, inside of your first month, how's the experience been? What are you missing? Yeah. What do you feel like we're doing really well? And then I think equally as important, if people do exit your organization, you should be asking why. You should make the investment and the time to say, why are you leaving? And then you can better understand and take all of that information and those metrics to be able to help you in your retention strategies.
Perfect. 2 to 5 years, I don't know what you're seeing, but 2 to 5 years, that time frame where you lose, where we're losing people. And so understanding that, like, where are you losing it, and really make sure you're honing in on those touch points and data collection with that segment of your, in that cohort of your workforce.
That's great advice. Well, this has been great. So folks, if you've listened to the crew here, obviously advocate, get connected with your team, focus on culture. And I guess my little last parting thought is just do something every day. It's most important, this topic of workforce. It's more important than anything else that you do as an operator out there. Find something, do something every day to move that needle on employee retention, employee engagement, culture, all these topics. But Sonnie, Ken, you know, known you guys for a long time, consider you guys leaders on this front. Love listening to you. Wish we had 2 hours, but thank you so much. Thanks to the Axxess team for putting this on, and appreciate everybody's time. If you have any further questions, feel free to reach out. We're happy to talk on this topic at any given point.
Yeah. Thank you all for sharing your expertise and wisdom. We will, just as a reminder, be sending everyone a link to the video recording. And in a moment, all attendees will see a GoToWebinar survey pop up. Please just take 2 minutes just to share your feedback and thoughts on today's webinar. And by the way, if you haven't checked out the Axxess user community, I encourage you to visit community.axxess.com. It's a great place to share information, ask a question, and connect with other Axxess users to keep learning and growing. Thank you again for your time today.
Thank you for joining our on-demand training today. Axxess is the only home healthcare technology company approved by the American Nurses Credentialing Center to offer continuing education credits and the most recommended home health software on Software Advice. You can watch more on-demand training videos through our industry-leading help center or at axxess.com, where you'll find tutorials, blogs, white papers, and answers to frequently asked questions. Axxess. Empowering care anytime, anywhere.